Hi, I'm David Field. As an actor, one of the most energetic people I've worked with is filmmaker David Batty. David struck gold 15 years ago with the TV series Bush Mechanics, his hilarious take on getting around the outback with no roadside assistance. Now, despite a family tragedy that took him to the brink, David's back with a new screen adventure. But just how did a white guy from Wollongong end up making films about Indigenous life? This is David's story.
David's an outsider and a maverick who has fitted in with Aboriginal people. He's just captured the liveliness and the spirit of us.
Filmmaking for David is a really physical activity, so he really throws himself into the camera work. He's kind of part of the action.
I really enjoy that full-on Boise action as much as the guys.
You guys have come out of the swamp.
David's making some of the best Indigenous programs we've seen. And he's sort of mad, you know, he loved driving around out bush and hunting and camping and, you know, he loved all that whole free, spirited life. But he also had a really distinctive, crazy view on the world. He is a high risk taker and he's pretty much up for anything. He became one of us, really.
I'm very comfortable throwing the swag out on the ground somewhere and foraging or going off hunting with people and eating whatever they hunt and they cook it in the coals.
How's the tucker, David?
Can't beat fresh fish.
And I have a strong appreciation for Aboriginal people's relationship to the land and country.
Better than McDonald's, eh?
And just their love of going bush.
He has an understanding of country in a very similar way to how Aboriginal people think of country.
Everyone ready? Washing.
I think it's just a genuine kind of connection with place. You know, for David, I think it's something that goes back to his childhood.
I was really blessed with a beautiful childhood. And sort of tears of joy, really, not sadness. There was just the two of us, my brother Philip and I. Dad was really keen bushman. He was a very, very keen bushwalker, keen canoeist.
We start in the headwaters and spend a couple of weeks just canoeing down the river and camping by some rapids and catching fish.
Kids came with us from very early age, and I always used to make sure they wore red shirts so we'd see them in the bush somewhere.
We'd walk into the bush for more than a week without any bedding or anything like that. We'd have just a ground sheet under a cave. And we're both given that real love of the bush and the environment from an early age.
Well, I was at high school in Wollongong, got involved with a girl, Rita, and she was of Italian migrant family. I was absolutely devastated when I had to eventually tell my parents that I had a girl pregnant. The conversation back to me from Rita's father was something like, "Dev, you'll marry Rita." And that was about the long and the short of it. So a week after I left school, I got married. Chris was born. Dad died. That was a huge blow. Rita said, well, I'm moving to Melbourne. I felt I had no choice but to tag along and go down there as well.
Get out of the frame. Masculine is to do more than feminine is to be done.
Rita really kind of got enthralled by the whole separatist feminist environment at that time. You know, I remember her sort of saying, well, I don't want to play this role of a mother anymore.
So me and Chris moved into the household with the Males Against Sexism. And of course, none of them changed nappies or made bottles or got up through the night.
Melbourne was bleak, miserable, cold. I had no money, got my own with a baby. Yeah, so there wasn't much light around at that time.
Rita really went off and pursued her own life after that. From that time, I pretty well had Chris most of the time from there on in.
That's my annual winter pilgrimage up in Central Australia. I just get so excited coming into Alice Springs. I just love Central Australia. I love everything about it.
I just wanted a whole new life. So I bought an old panel van and me and Chris got in that and we drove to Alice Springs. From arriving in Alice Springs, I just felt at home.
Yeah! I went to the Aboriginal community of Papunya in 1977. David arrived in Alice Springs to join me, I think it was 81.
And it was a great environment for Chris. He just loved it and he thrived. He really thrived in Alice Springs.
Because David had to pretty much bring up Chris by himself, we tended to identify with Chris as, yeah, like a brother or a younger sibling. So they sort of knocked around together as sort of older brother, younger brother.
A lot of people were coming to Central Australia because they wanted to be a part of the Indigenous world. It was a great moment of possibility and change. And Philip Batty and David Batty were part of that movement who wanted to make a contribution, and they did.
Okay, good morning. This is Aitken FM and also VL8A. And this is Aboriginal Radio in Aboriginal Country.
My brother and Frieda Thornton and Johnny McCumber, they set up an organisation called Karma, which is a Central Australian Aboriginal Media Association.
And now it's time for Colin Pan with the Pitch and Jar Show.
Hello, my name's Philip Batty. I'm the Projects and Administration Officer here at Karma.
The aim was to create a voice in the media for Aboriginal people. And that was all forms of media.
Let alone a service in their own language.
Because at that point, there was nothing at all for Aboriginal people.
Listening again tomorrow at 7:30 for Aboriginal Radio in Aboriginal Country. Goodbye now and have a good night.
This is Karma Radio on 8KIN FM.
It was like a mangy dog radio station, you know. It had no money and no resources. And suddenly people were listening in to this station, bringing them news and information about their people in their own languages.
And then they decided that they really should be getting into video. And so we started the Karma TV unit. And I had four Aboriginal trainees.
And I got a traineeship at Karma, and Karma just opened up a whole world for me. For young Indigenous people, you know, the stuff that was coming out of Karma in terms of music, television and radio was just electrifying.
Very early in the piece, I met Alison.
Hello, everybody. This is a video about Jack and all of us at McKay Street.
Well, we owned a house together in Alice Springs.
And this is my new room.
I mean, it was Chris and David for a long time. They were a little team. Chris was, he was a really busy kid, really energetic. I guess he was a risk taker too. He was always on the go, always outside. And here's David.
Me, Jackie.
And David Nipperbarth, Jack Normalisa. We've got to get this on video.
And it was just a simple life. And then we had Jack, and then we had Frank, and then we had Nick.
This is the Betty family.
After some time, they got married, and that was a big community wedding. And we all went to the local park afterwards. So that was a big part of his life, the family, always from the start.
I got a request from Yundamu. Can you come in and make these children's programs? A bit like Sesame Street, but in Walpri, in a Walpri language.
Manu won it for the first time. Captured Aboriginal children on TV. You've just never seen Aboriginal children in that way before. With David Batty and his skin brother, Francis Kelly, with their warped humour and, you know, creative craziness that they both bring in their collaborations.
Chubrula to Chubrula, we are brothers, we respect each other. Whatever you do, I help him. Whatever I do, he helps me.
Manu Wanu has attracted interest and funding from the London-based Channel 4. Success is largely because of this man, David Batty.
And, I think it's been a long time coming.
About 10 years after I did Manu Wanu, I got a call from Yundamu. We want you to come down and make a film about young men and cars. So when I got down there, it was all the same guys that were in Manu Wanu, but they were 10 years older.
Up, man, I'm not ready for a little while.
Tell them to keep going, this mob you
want. You want, call out with them though.
Francis actively co-directed Bush Mechanics. You know, in Walbury, talking to the boys on the radio and calling shots and stuff.
That's the last one, eh?
I'm going to move over that hill and get one more with that hill there coming down there.
We like to work together as a team, you know.
Don't hurry up.
Quick. One more, last one.
Go fast.
We joke, we tease each other. We work together.
So the core of Bush Mechanics was basically a road trip where you had the crappiest car in the world and things would inevitably go wrong and no one has any money or any resources and you can't ring up anyone to help you, so you have to innovate. So things like stuffing a flat tire with Spinifex so it gets you that extra 10 km, or getting a tree and carving it to make a crankshaft. It became like a cult classic. I took the country in a very quiet way by storm.
These bush solutions to sort of impossible situations that anyone else would just be like, call the NRMA, you know, get the...
He's had a new idea, right? The guy's in prison and he's sitting there and he's rung up you guys. You guys are coming in to pick him up, right?
Mm-hmm.
Back then, white fellas had this strange relationship where they'd work with Aboriginal people during the day and then, you know, knock off at 5 o'clock and they might discuss us over dinner, but they never socialised with us. David camped with black fellas, knocked around with us. You know, he's one of us.
We won an award in Sydney. It's called AFI Award. And we were proud to be in that ward.
And the cameraman at the moment is Sunset Chubrula from Western Australia.
And he's over here.
And that's our lady. She'll be working with us. And she'll be looking after us and wash our clothes.
I met David when he was finishing off the first bush mechanics program, and we just kind of hit it off immediately, I have to say.
Bush mechanics finished now. Too hard.
So where does this road go, Jen?
This road you pick up in Halls Creek.
She became like my producer. We made a lot of documentaries for television.
Yeah, I think David's later career really took off when he met Jen, because she took over and ordered David's chaotic filmmaking, and they've gone on to make, you know, quite a lot of prize-winning documentaries.
Isn't that a role, David? Mm-hmm. I can edit it.
David got the job in the Kimberley, and then we set up home in Broome.
This is where Georgina sleeps, in here, in the cot.
Then Gina came and...
It was a good life, it was a very good life. And I made good money, and we all prospered, and the kids loved it in Broome.
Mum!
Oh, you know what I saw down at the old camp, David? And then we sort of got into this Kimberley life of fishing and going camping.
David did a fantastic pack, far better than Jen and I could have ever possibly have done.
What would you have to say on that, Jen?
It was a disaster.
I was very much a part of David's family.
What do you think, Mum?
Amputation.
You know, I was also a single mother.
But he's been very brave, Jen.
My son, Oscar, was very much a part of David's family. And... yeah, very, really, very close to David's kids.
Did you sleep well, Oscar?
Yeah.
Yeah, we had a good night's sleep.
Look, for a long time, David really did kind of live, you know, kind of like a parallel life, where he had this incredibly loving and supportive family life.
We hope you've enjoyed this interlude into our private lives.
And then he had another kind of life, I guess, with me, which was basically based around his other passion in life, which was filmmaking.
We're saying goodbye to Chrissy. Bye, Chrissy.
My son, Chris, he went off and found his own way pretty early in the piece.
Love.
So I think at that time he'd finished high school. And then so he was out in the big wide world.
He was a self-made person, just like his dad, an environmentalist, rehabilitating mine sites. And so, yeah, he was highly in demand for that work.
And then he met Yale. He married Yale in Broome.
I've got a wife next to me now, so I'm all confident.
They bought a house, and then they bought another house. And then he had the flash Toyota. Brand new Toyota.
And again.
Yay! Chris's mother, Rita, kind of fell through the cracks. She ended up having health issues and she contracted cancer. So Chris went down and he really nursed her to her death. And so really that was about the most time he'd spent with her since he was a little child. I know he did pocket some of his mother's morphine and stuff. About a year or so after his mother's death, Chris's wife, Gail, she was overseas, and he'd been out fishing with his close friends and then came back and they continued to party on.
Chris would have probably drunk more than the others. And then at that point where they made this decision to take some of the morphine, I imagine Chris would have probably taken more than the others.
And I was in Melbourne studio and I got a call from Frank, my son. He just knew something was wrong straight away. he just said, "Dad, Dad, Chris is dead. Chris is dead," like that. And I just fell to the floor. Basically, I just collapsed. I just couldn't believe it.
The thing about Chris was he was so close to his dad. You know, it's a sad thing that, you know, we lost Chris.
Now, I grew him up, you know. It was just me and him. And it just makes it so much more tragic, you know, that we were a team.
Chris dying hit David probably harder than any loss that I've ever witnessed before. David was shattered to his core. Losing Chris was a double whammy because it set up a chain of events that led to the breakdown of his marriage.
It became apparent that I hadn't been faithful.
So not only was all this grief, but then everything just went, it was just this whole kind of explosion. The family just went poof.
When it was revealed that David had had a relationship with his business partner, Jen, it really had a completely shattering effect on not just the family, David's family, and the baddies in generally, but friends and people that had known Dave for a long time.
I also accept that it was very damaging, and it caused a lot of hurt. I mean, a huge regret, a huge loss, and an incredible amount of pain that's you know, around that, and still is. Yeah.
I was thrown out of the house. The kids didn't have any respect for me. My wife, Alison, didn't want to know me at that time. And I lost Chris. I just lost everything.
I should have been kinder to him, but I was furious, so I didn't feel like being kind to him. And, you know, while I understood how tormented he was, and he was deeply in a state of deep torment, I was so utterly furious with him.
I was destitute, emotionally destitute. I was lucky to have survived that. About a year after Chris had passed, I was kind of pretty lost in space. Francis asked me to make this film about the Coniston Massacre. It was like my salvation, really. It was really like I needed something to hang on to at that time because I'd lost everything.
Coniston is the last recorded massacre of Aboriginal people in Central Australia. It happened in 1928.
Norman and everyone back!
In retribution for an Aboriginal man killing a white man who'd taken his wife.
Put down your weapon in the name of the king.
The police came in and basically murdered women, men and children in a very wide distance, just shot everyone, killed them all. And Francis always wanted to tell this story.
It's taken me 30 years to make this film properly.
People say we forgive, but we can never forget. And the Coniston Massacre film was important for recognising that massacre.
You what?
Huh? Yeah. It was the highlight of the whole show. It was the highlight of the whole thing. No, I've reconciled with the kids. There's probably an undercurrent of resentment there towards the way things panned out there, but that's something that I carry and that I do find upsetting and I just have to live with.
Hey, Jen, check this out.
Look. Yeah, she's my partner now. Yeah. Yeah, while I would call her my partner, we only have a few weeks of the year together, in reality.
I think it's pretty good.
She's in the city, and I'm in the middle of the bush.
It's good having the names of the guys.
Yeah, I was going to say...
Identify the characters. Yeah.
These young guys from Arnhem Land approached us. They were huge fans of Bush Mechanics.
Not just gratuitous killing stuff, it's getting food to bring back to the community.
No, well, exactly. So if that's what they're doing, you've also got to have that as a payoff.
They sent David a little video of the adventures that they get up to in the bush.
And then you'll have to jump out pretty quick.
Yeah.
We'll try drowning in there.
I won't drown. No.
He's gone up to Arnhem Land and he's making Bush Mechanics sort of in the top end in Black Haz. So again, a bunch of guys with crap cars do extraordinary things, but this time in crocodile infested Arnhem Land.
It's four young men. One of them's white.
Then I put it in fourth and it dropped down even when red line and two twenty.
Which is an interesting dynamic, which I actually really like.
You're going to wreck this car if you drive it like that.
I know. Not for luck. Going to KFC drive-thru.
It's hard talking to you guys.
I'm listening.
We're listening. I'm listening. We're going to find a bomb.
Find a bomb.
Joe was adopted by a family in Remangini, and he's gone through law. He's been initiated. He knows all the stories.
We've got to get muddy again.
I think most of the community see me as a Yolngu person.
So it's pressed there, walked up.
Used to never live with my parents at home. Always used to just go out fishing and hunting every day with the boys.
The local language has become his first language, so English is now Joe's second language. Those Black Ass guys are incredibly ingenious. Honestly, I was left in awe so many times. Any of them will just come up with a solution like that. Bang, we've got to do this. And really inventive.
That's actually real. That's what we do. That's how we live off the land.
Crocodiles, you know, like crocodiles everywhere. They just love nothing more than going hunting. And it's not always about the kill. It's about the adventure. And then they love to bring it back and share that food with community members.
There's something very life-affirming for these young black fellas to be together and doing their thing and on their land, you know? It's a great spirit of freedom, and that's David's gift, you know, to be able to capture that, you know, because it really shows us as we truly are.
I
I think David will always be a nomad, and he loves to wander out into the desert and make films. And I think he'll be doing that when he's in his 90s.
Years now I've been coming up here to Central Australia and being involved with Aboriginal people. Whenever I come here, I just feel like I'm coming home. I really do. I honestly feel like, oh, I've come home again.
I think Australian Aboriginal people are, they're survivors, you know. They really are remarkable. It makes you a lot more humble, and it also leaves you in awe. Aboriginal people gave me a much deeper understanding of the kind of relationship that you can have with the country.